God on the Move.
And they got to know of Nikolai Elminski, who said that we need to translate into the local living language, again, inspired by evangelical Bible translators of the time. And one young man here in Chuvashia translated one of the Gospels into the everyday Chuvash speech. And he got in touch with him, and a whole story of collaboration between this young man, with really this young man being an actual native Chuvash, and he went on to set up a lot of schools and primary schools among the Chuvash as well, where they were using their native Chuvash language, and they were using the Gospels and other Christian books as their textbooks in these schools.
The Chuvash Republic, or Chuvashia, is a republic of Russia located in Eastern Europe. It is the homeland of the Chuvash people, which is a Turkic ethnic group. The vast majority, about 65%, consider themselves as members of the Russian Orthodox Church. In comparison, the neighboring Republic of Tartistan has a 54% Muslim majority. On Wikipedia, you can read that, quote, between 1650 and 1850, the Russian Orthodox Church sent Chuvash-speaking missionaries to try to convert the Chuvash people to the Orthodox faith. A group of these missionaries created a written Chuvash language. End of quote. But as so often, there's a little bit more to that story. You are listening to God on the Move, a Lausanne Movement production, and this is a story about Orthodox missions and the Chuvash Republic. The voice you heard earlier is Dr. Alison Ruth Kolosova. She's a research fellow at the University of Tartu, Estonia. She co-chairs the missiology group of the International Orthodox Theological Association and is a member of the Europe Governing Board of the International Association for Mission Studies. And this is her story.
I'm Alison Kolosova, but I was born as Alison Backhouse in the UK. If I go back, say, at least to the 90s, perhaps that's the time when Russia started opening up to the rest of the world. That's perhaps a convenient place for me to start in many ways. And that's led to both me being here in Chuvashia and also eventually to what I'm doing also in Estonia today. Actually, I could go back a little bit further than the 90s in that in the late 70s, just at the end of the Soviet period, I was a young evangelical Christian in London at that time. I was part of the ecclesiology fellowship in the south of London, and I was involved in something called Aid to Russian Christians. At that time, things were pretty closed here in Russia, and there were a lot of Christians in prison. So I was part of this charity called Aid to Russian Christians, which partly was encouraging people in local churches in the UK, but it was also a little bit further afield as well, to be aware of what was going on among Christians here in Russia or in the Soviet Union, and also in different ways, sending different kinds of aid. That's why it was Aid to Russian Christians. We were sending books, scriptures, where it was possible to get books in, also practical aid to the families of people who were in prison, to their wives and children, trying to establish some kind of contact between the church here in Russia and the church in the UK. But also at the time, it was difficult. There were some people traveling in and out, there were others who were just praying. We would encourage people to send postcards to people just with messages that they hadn't forgotten, that kind of thing, a kind of prayer movement, if you like. And my family joked to me that just at the time that I started that work, the Soviet Union started opening up. So this was like 87, and there was a big wave of prisoners released at the beginning of 87. I'm sure it wasn't just our work, but lots of different people's work that led to that gradual opening up of the Soviet Union. I'd studied Russian, trying to think what the next kind of step would have been from there. As things opened up, I actually came to live in Russia, and I was working with Campus Crusade for Christ for 2 years in Moscow, working with students at Moscow University. At that time, Russia had just opened up to the big wide world. I mean, there was a lot of interest in any foreigner that came, and particularly in the Christian faith, because obviously for so long it had been hard to ask questions or to know very much. And we had quite a big response among the young people and students at Moscow University. And a lot of them are still believers today, and I'm still in touch with them. They're kind of friends today. That was also for me a time of getting to know the Orthodox Church. I'd known something about it before from an Orthodox community in the UK, which had been involved. I mean, this is interesting, really, for the Orthodox world. This is the Orthodox community of St. John of Kronstadt in Bath in the UK. But they were helping to prepare evangelical groups that came into Russia in the late 80s. So they were helping by doing things like just explaining some of the basics of Orthodoxy, or explaining things like how to use the icons in a church to explain the gospel and that kind of thing. So I was involved in training groups that were coming into Russia and getting that training from Orthodox Christians themselves. But that led to a deeper interest once I got to Russia. And obviously, we were surrounded by Orthodox churches, which were just opening up, a lot of them, meeting in really tumble down buildings because a lot of the churches had been destroyed in the Soviet period. So I was involved in that and got to know some different communities that were struggling to get going again in the early 90s. That eventually led to me asking questions about church history and where had this Orthodox church come from and where had my own evangelical faith come from and the Protestant churches in general. And obviously, it's a long story, but eventually, in kind of 1995 or so, I actually joined the Orthodox Church in the UK. So I was quite keen that my family should realise this wasn't just me being interested in exotic Russian faith, but it was something that I was accepting as an English woman. That obviously raised the question of what do I do with Campus Crusade, because Campus Crusade wasn't particularly keen on its staff members being Orthodox and encouraging people who became Christians through Bible studies and through evangelism. They weren't particularly keen that we'd be taking those to Orthodox churches, which is what I was doing. In the end, just to cut a long story short, I ended up becoming Orthodox and leaving Campus Crusade. And I was in the UK for a little while, wondering where I go from here. But in the end, I ended up coming back to Chuvashia, which is where I am now, partly through just some teacher friends that I'd met whilst in Moscow with Campus Crusade. In fact, they'd helped with translating for an evangelistic campaign that was being held. And they said, oh, come to visit us in Chuvashia. And I didn't really know much about Chuvashia then, but I was very interested. Chuvashia is the eastern border, if you like, of the, what you could call the Christian parts of Russia. The next republic eastwards from us is the Tatar Republic, where most people are Muslim. And then you've got Bashkortostan, which is also Muslim as well. The Chuvash, they are a Turkic people, so related to the Tatars and related to all the different Turkic peoples, you know, the Turks, the Kazakh. But interestingly enough, they are Christian and they are mainly Orthodox Christian. And that's largely due to a missionary movement from the Orthodox Church in the late 19th century, when all the Bible and the church texts and things were translated in this Turkic Chuvash language. That's one strand, if you like. Once I arrived here in Chuvashia, that's one strand of what I got interested in, and which is what eventually has led to maybe going more into the direction of scholarship and interest in the history of Christian missions. But also, when I arrived here at first, I became an English teacher in a local school, or in two local schools. And at the time, I was also studying at an Orthodox Theological Institute in Paris, just as an external student. So that meant that eventually I got involved in teaching in the parish where I was here in Chuvashia, partly among children and then partly in the prison ministry. It's a very active prison ministry in Chuvashia, which is throughout all the prisons in Chuvashia, with lay people going into the different prisons and teaching and just befriending people in the prisons. And quite an amazing work, I would say, led by a very dynamic Orthodox priest in Chuvashia. These were the kind of strands, like church ministry, that I got involved with eventually. And that's what I've spent a lot of my time here in Chuvashia. I'm also a musician, so I ended up in church music and ended up working with young people who wanted to learn to sing as well. So that's been a way of drawing people to faith as well. I would say in Orthodoxy, there isn't so much the kind of presenting people with the four laws and expecting them to respond, but a gradual drawing of people into relationship with God through worship, just through making them aware of the Bible and its teaching and through the church community. I would say that's more how evangelism takes place. So that's the kind of thing I've been involved with here. I got interested in the history of mission here. It's quite an amazing story, really, how Turkic Chuvash people. I think I read somewhere that they are the only Turkic people who are predominantly Christian today. And this is really due to this evangelical movement at the end of the 19th century, sort of just before the Russian Revolution or in the last 50 years before that. And it's a very active part played in that by the British and Foreign Bible Society. And so evangelical Bible societies, for me, it's also a classic example of how evangelical Christians have also played a major role in different aspects of awakening, if you like, within the Orthodox churches at different times. I could give you other examples as well, but there has been a lot of connection there. And whilst it may not have led to lots of people becoming evangelical Christians, it's often triggered off things within Orthodoxy itself, a greater emphasis on reading scripture, on personal faith. And that, I would say that's very much something that's been the case here in Chuvashia and that people aren't that aware of. So that's why I've ended up more in the scholarly field in recent years. And now, although I'm living here in Chuvashia, I'm actually based scholarly-wise at Tartu University. I'm in the School of Theology and Religious Studies, and I'm part of a research team which is actually looking at the history of Orthodoxy in Estonia, which is interesting in itself, but I'm attached to that team from afar. So anyway, that's a very long version of who I am, but just a very quick-potted version of what I've been doing for the last 30 years.
As with my conversation with Nathan Hoppe in episode 7, I wanted to get her personal perspective on the interdenominational tensions between evangelical Christians and the Orthodox tradition. To my regret, I regularly hear people talk quite negatively about more liturgical traditions. It would often be described as dead and boring, weird, or just outright wrong. Because Alison is so familiar with the evangelical as well as the Orthodox Church, I wanted to get her opinion on this.
First of all, I would say I can very much identify with those kind of feelings. If I think back to myself, probably in the 80s or so, when I was first getting to know Orthodox, and even when my first visits to the community in the UK, where everything's in English, and yet I could still go to the services and think, you know, what is going on here and why are they so long? And it goes on and I haven't a clue what's going on. And I can remember that feeling very much. And obviously it's a whole journey over many years that eventually led me to becoming Orthodox. But if I can pinpoint one or two things, I would say perhaps the first thing is that it's very much a faith that embodies your whole being, body and soul. I think increasingly I found as an evangelical, a lot of it was in my head and it was reading scripture and getting to know scripture, which is all very wonderful. And I feel it's all very much there in Orthodoxy, in good, the best versions of Orthodoxy, if you like. But I think sometimes there can be a tendency to kind of, it didn't really affect my heart. And I think often I could walk into an Orthodox service and just this sense of the presence of God somehow, which I rarely found in an evangelical worship that I attended.
From personal experience and people I've talked to, this resonated with me. Early on in my theological education, I therefore developed an increased interest in God's holiness and have been fascinated by a sincere reverence towards God, something I also noticed when first visiting an Orthodox church in Minsk in Belarus. Hence my question if this was what she was talking about.
There is a general kind of reverence for God, but I think perhaps it's more than that. I think when I say that it's a whole experience of body and spirit, you've got the very physical side of Orthodox worship, whether it's icons, which a lot of evangelicals would have problems with and think of it as idolatry. But from an Orthodox point of view, the icon is a consequence of the fact that Christ has become incarnate. Christ has become man and taken on physical matter. He actually became a physical human being. So they would justify the use of icons on that front, that the icon is an extension of Christ's incarnation, that God's presence can be there in physical things, whether it's in the wood of an icon or in holy water that is sprinkled on people or in oil that's used to anoint people. That God's presence is communicated, not just through words, which I think is very much the emphasis in evangelical Christianity, but through the physical things of this world. And I think there's a whole basis there for theology, ecology, and care for the environment, which is there as well, and which develops out of this whole theology of God's presence in the physical things of this world. I think that's one side. But another thing that eventually ended up with me becoming Orthodox is realizing so much of the things that I actually cherished in evangelical Christianity, whether it's the emphasis on the word or on a kind of personal faith and a real direct living relationship with God, that I could find those in Orthodoxy. I know a lot of people would think of the Orthodox Church perhaps as dead. If you actually look at an Orthodox service, and I think sadly, a lot of people, say in the UK today, might only have access to a service in Greek or Romanian or Slavonic, whereas I very fortunately had access to a community where everything was in English. And if you actually look at the services of the Orthodox Church, it's all scripture, basically. It's reading scripture collectively. So you could almost say it's an extension of an evangelical Bible study, except that it's all in the context of worship and standing before God. So there's a lot of reading of the Psalms, reading of the Old Testament, the New Testament, and then a lot of the actual liturgy itself is phrases from the Bible which are being prayed. So in that sense, I found a fulfillment of the great emphasis on script, but perhaps in some ways I found a deepening of that, I think, partly because you are reading scripture in the context of worship. But I think also for all the evangelical love of scripture, at times certain bits get left out. And okay, this is me 30 years after having become Orthodox, so perhaps I'm not in touch with contemporary evangelicalism and perhaps everybody's into these passages. But for example, in the Orthodox Church, there's a whole feast, big feast day, so almost on the level of, say, Easter or Christmas for Orthodox, but it's the Feast of Christ's Transfiguration. And I can remember as an evangelical, occasionally, I can even remember going on a weekend away with the Ecclesiology Fellowship in London and as reading the passage about Christ's transfiguration and none of us really having a clue what this was about. And somehow it's a passage that a lot of evangelicals don't have much idea what it's all about, whereas I think there is a whole theology behind what's happening at the Feast of the Transfiguration or at Christ's Transfiguration, and that's expressed through this major feast day. In some ways, I found there were bits of scripture that somehow I'd never really found much emphasis on or much interest in or much explanation of in even evangelicalism, that suddenly there was a depth to scripture that I hadn't known before. Even though I would still say today that the vast majority of evangelicals have got much, much better knowledge of scripture than an awful lot of Orthodox. And I think the Orthodox have got a lot to learn from evangelicals area.
I know the audio here was not very clear, but what she said is, I think the Orthodox have got a lot to learn from evangelicals in that area. Undoubtedly, we can all learn from each other. Each tradition has a unique emphasis and understanding that other brothers and sisters can and should learn from. What I found particularly interesting about the Chuvash Republic is how evangelicalism influenced Orthodox Christians in that region to bring lasting change. It's an encouraging example of the power of the unity of the church.
The period I'm referring to is that in the 1860s, there was a particular man, teacher, linguist called Nikolai Ilminsky, who was based in Kazan, which is today the capital of the Tatar Republic, which is just a little bit further east from us, but it's a few hours away by car or by train from where I am. And although he was very Orthodox, and I would say that towards the end of his life, he got a bit anti-evangelicals, but I would say that he was very influenced by the fact that it was the time when among evangelicals there was a big emphasis on translating the Bible, as obviously there is now. But there had particularly things like the British and Foreign Bible Society was able to act very freely here in Russia. It went really back to the 1820 or so, although it was banned for a while. But from the 1860s, when things in general opened up here again in Russia as well, it was the time of the emancipation of the serfs and things like that. The British and Foreign Bible Society was very active again, and they got to know of Nikolai Ilminsky, who said that we need to translate into the local living language, again inspired by evangelical Bible translators of the time. And one young man here in Chuvashia translated one of the Gospels into the everyday Chuvash speech. This was the late 1860s, and the headquarters of the British and Foreign Bible Society was in St. Petersburg at the time. And the man who was the head of the British and Foreign Bible Society, he was on the lookout for people like this young man who translated one of the Gospels. and he got in touch with him, and a whole story of collaboration between this young man, with really this young man being an actual native Chuvash, and he went on to set up a lot of schools and primary schools among the Chuvash as well, where they were using their native Chuvash language, and they were using the Gospels and other Christian books as their textbooks in these schools. And because they were Orthodox, they were translating the Orthodox services into the Chuvash language as well. And this became the content of a whole educational movement and of the first real primary education among the Chuvash. There wasn't really any money to fund all of this. So the British and Foreign Bible Society, they were not only providing the funding for the printing and the distribution of these publications, and then they often would be distributing themselves. So the Chuvash would be distributing them in their schools, and then the British and Foreign Bible Society just walk around the villages with scriptures and sell them. And it was a very business-like, in many ways, relationship, because the British and Foreign Bible Society didn't have the access to the local people who could do the translation work. This young man, who ended up being known today as the father of the Chuvash education system, and he was the one who ended up setting up this whole network of primary schools using the Chuvash language. But the British and Foreign Bible Society had the vision that they wanted people to have the Word of God by 1910. So literally on the eve of the revolution here in Russia, they published the whole of the New Testament in the Chuvash language. Gradually, over about 40 years, different books were translated and then finally published the whole thing. And that was funded largely by the British and Foreign Bible Society. And in many ways, that was laying a whole foundation for the Christian faith among the Chuvash people, which 7 years later there was the revolution, churches being closed, any Christian literature being confiscated for several decades. Really, at the most crucial time, the British and Foreign Bible Society, because of its vision of wanting people to have the scripture, made this huge contribution, I would say, to the history and culture, and it helped to give a written language to the Chuvash people. I mean, today, the Chuvash, there are probably, I don't know, about a million or so Chuvash today who speak the Chuvash language. And I'm friends with some of the people who are activists for preserving the Chuvash language, because they feel that it could quite easily just disappear today, being lots of people are using Russian as their mother tongue and just not being brought up to speak Chuvash. So it's a bit like the Welsh language in the UK, for example. There's a big active movement to try and preserve the language. And really, if it hadn't become a written, published language, really through the vision of the British and Foreign Bible Society, I think it would be in an even much worse state than it is today. It could have completely down to a few hundred thousand people, I think. Yeah, I think the British and Foreign Bible Society, even though perhaps they didn't play the key role, they played a very humble role of serving the local Orthodox church and being aware of what the Orthodox could do. But a whole interesting, huge correspondence between the Orthodox here and British Reformed Bible Society in London about how they should behave in certain situations. And it's all quite fascinating. But that's the practical level, how things work. It was a very fruitful, down-to-earth relationship in many ways, two sides that could see that the other could help them. But it did cause some people saying, oh, we're Orthodox, we shouldn't be relying on funding from abroad, from evangelicals. I mean, it's a big sensitive issue in mission as a whole. But I think in many ways, that as far as they could in that situation, very much let the local people play their part. And as a result, it's the local Chuvash who are remembered as the father of this, or the man in particular, Ivan Yakovlev, who's known as the enlightener of the Chuvash today, for having created this written language. There's not so much emphasis on the evangelicals that were behind that. So that's why I'm saying it was a humble, modest role, which nevertheless, if they hadn't played it, there wouldn't be the situation there is today.
I found this really fascinating. It reminds me of the importance to study church history, not just from the early church, but also the more recent history. And further, stressing the interconnectedness and the interrelation between church, politics, society, education, etc., etc. But knowing history isn't worth much if we're not able to learn from it and to understand how it has shaped the present. So I was eager to find out more about the state of the Chuvash Church today.
I would say there are all kinds of different trends and obviously different people with different opinions, and there are all kinds of different things I could say. I've already mentioned a little bit the prison ministry here. I would say that for me is perhaps a very good example of how there is a very living side to the church here. There's one particular priest in Cheboksary, Father Alexei Pavlov, and he's in charge of the whole prison ministry. So he spends a lot of his time traveling around the Republic and supporting the priests who are going into prisons. And there's been a lot of work done both in building, actual building, church buildings in prisons, which there weren't until a couple of decades ago. In our own prison here in Alatyr, the church, I can't remember exactly now, but probably about 10 to 15 years ago, the actual church building was opened again, although there'd been a ministry of people going in. But I think what is very encouraging in the way Father Alexei, a kind of principle he's adopted, which in some ways reminds me of this, of the work that was done in the 19th century, is that he's very much trained ordinary lay people to go in. For example, I've been up in Cheboksary and attended sessions where he's basically teaching people to teach the Bible in the prisons. So he teaches them, first of all, what in the Orthodox Church would be called catechism, where you're being taught the basics of the faith. And then those people are going into the prison and really passing that on. In a way, he's killing two birds with one stone. He's teaching his own people and then teaching them to teach the people in the prison. And often the people in the prison then become teachers themselves. And a lot of them, when they've been released, they've actually come and joined the local parishes in the town where they are, some of them, and become some of the most dynamic witnesses in those parishes.
Before we continue with the story, I want to let you know that we want to share mission stories from the Global Church with the Global Church. So if you have a story to share or know someone who might have, please contact us at podcast@lausanne.org. That is podcast@lausanne.org.
I think of our own prison here. It's a very wonderful lady called Liena who really was in the depths of despair early in the prison because it's a women's prison. And a lot of the women there, they're there for drugs related offences. And often they've been drug trafficking in some way. And then they might be in prison, say, for 2 or 3 years. They're not getting great long sentences as they might for murder or something like that. But then they get out of the prison and then they just fall back into the same thing all over again. There's just no way of getting out of this cycle. And so a lot of the women, they're there for a second, third, fourth time. And this woman, Lena, she was just in this depths of despair. How do I get out of this? And it was really through beginning to read the Christian books in, there's a library there created by the people who were going to visit, but obviously so that the women there could be reading. And she just began to read and was reading the scriptures and reading all kinds of stuff, just a kind of hunger to think, how can I change myself? How can I get out of this kind of cycle of doing the same things over and over again? I didn't mean she became this kind of saint overnight. But when she left the prison, eventually she came and lived in the parish in Alatyr because she'd got to know us through us visiting. And I think that helped her to also to break this cycle of dependence on both on the drugs and then on the drug trafficking and the whole drug trafficking circles that she was part of. And she's just an amazing kind of testimony to all of us and of somebody who really knew what it meant to be really trapped in sin, you can call it. And I would point to that as one example of where the church is very much alive, obviously, perhaps in any church, but perhaps in particular when it is a national church or a church that people have expected to go to because it's part of their national heritage, which is what it is for a lot of people here in Russia, then there is a tendency, obviously, among some people for it to just be something that they don't really know about. Perhaps they just go and put up a candle, but there is that side to it. I would say that in our town here in Alatyr, the way they've mainly been trying to deal with that really is through work in schools. A lot of teachers have been trained to teach about the Christian faith in the schools themselves, so a bit like RE teachers, you could say. And some of those then end up getting involved in the different forms of youth work that there are in the diocese. And I'm aware that it's not an ideal situation, so I don't want to say everything is hunky-dory, which it isn't. I've just, over the years, just come to the conclusion that through the worst and the most grim situations, when even through what I might think of the worst and the grimmest most people, God can still be at work there, and God can reach people even in situations which are the least bit ideal, or where things aren't happening the way you would love them to be happening, or it may not look as though God's there at all. But he is, and he can be.
What a wonderful and true statement that is. Through the worst and most grim situations, and even through the worst and grimmest people, God can still be at work there, and God can reach people, even in situations which are the least bit ideal, or where things aren't happening the way you would love them to be happening, or they may not look as though God is there at all. But he is, and he can be. This made me wonder how Alison has seen God at work throughout the Chuvash history, and what the biggest challenges are today. In this context, she mentions the war in Ukraine, which at the time of recording had been going on for about 18 months.
I do think the two questions are related. Obviously, the Soviet past is very much connected with what I would consider the greatest challenges today. I suppose from an Orthodox point of view, looking at the Soviet period within the Orthodox Church and within all of the Orthodox churches that went through the communist period and the persecutions, the notion of the new martyrs, those who actually suffered for the faith, were killed for the faith. I don't think in any way from an Orthodox point of view you could look at it and say, oh, it's just completely grim and without God. And I would say almost the opposite, that in some ways it took the church back to the time of the early martyrs of the Christian church, and many people who died for the faith and bore witness in an incredible way. The parish in the UK where I became Orthodox in the end, and it's called the parish of St John of Kronstadt in Bath, one of the people who is very much revered there, or the saints who's revered there, is known as the new martyr Elizabeth, and she was in fact the granddaughter of Queen Victoria. She was the sister of the last Tsaritsa of Russia, and her husband was blown up by a bomb in 1905, kind of a revolutionary threw a bomb at his carriage. He was the governor of Moscow at the time, so it was early expression of revolution, even though it was before the actual 1917 revolution. And after that, she went on to found a sisterhood of nurses who were serving among the sick and the poor of Moscow. But because she was from the royal family, she was the sister of the Tsarina. When the royal family, or the Tsarist family, was killed in 1918, she also was thrown down a mineshaft with several other members of the royal family in July 1918. But because she had this nurse's training, and she didn't actually die straight away down this mineshaft, there was another member of the royal family who was, they kind of got caught on a ledge together rather than falling right to the bottom. And even though she was obviously terribly wounded herself, and this other member of the royal family, they both died eventually, she was actually tore up her clothes to bind his wounds right down there in the mineshaft. And an amazing story, really, of somebody who, when her husband was killed by the bomb, she actually went to the prison and said that she forgave the man. Just an amazing testimony, really. She was, again, somebody from an evangelical Lutheran background who she became Orthodox when she married the Grand Prince Sergei of Russia. So she had this dual background, if you like, of Protestantism and Orthodoxy in her. And I think it was her mother's example as a little girl. She'd taken her to hospitals in Germany where she grew up. And so she took that into the Orthodox world, if you like, and she became this amazing witness amidst what you say is the horrific side of the revolution, a witness to the faith and to the love of God and the capacity to forgive amidst the worst evil. And today, the biggest issue in terms of the actual war in Ukraine, which is absolutely ghastly. For many Orthodox, I think, around the world, it's this kind of two Orthodox countries fighting each other, or one Orthodox country that has invaded the other one and is blowing up the others. And at times, I think a lot of us, particularly those of us with a heart for mission in the Orthodox Church, we think, how can we even begin to speak of mission amidst this horrific situation? It's a situation that has enormous historical roots that go back centuries. It also goes back into the Soviet period and then into more specific recent causes. And obviously it would be another whole hour just talking about all of those. And I think that obviously for me is the greatest challenge and problem, I would say, particularly of the Russian church at the moment. For me, the way how it's affected me in many ways, it's not something that's just started over the last 18 months. I've mentioned that I've been involved with youth work, with the prison ministry, and already, I would say, 15 years ago, there was a whole side to the way young people were being taught in the church, which gradually I just felt I couldn't agree with. And a lot of it was a very, what I would just describe as basic military training that was being brought into, this is certainly not in the whole of the Russian church, but in some of the parishes where I am here, very strong. I suppose like in any church, you've got some people who are more radical than others. And I would say this very militant view of Orthodoxy and linked with a very nationalistic view of Orthodoxy. So a sense of Orthodoxy is our Russian faith and people thinking we're the only ones who've got the right way. There are certain wings of the Orthodox Church and it's perhaps more than wings. It's perhaps more a kind of more generalized phenomenon, but it's certainly not everybody. You have a sense of we are the ones who have the true faith and in that we have orthodoxy. But even more than that, we Russians have got the true version of orthodoxy. And that is one of the hugest issues that the Russian church has to face. It partly has arisen, and I mean, as I said earlier, is linked to the whole issue of the Soviet period. Sense of, I think, after the Soviet period in the 90s, myself, I was part of this openness to all the Protestant groups coming in and evangelizing Russia. I'm as guilty of this as anybody else. I think there's a kind of backlash towards that within the Orthodox Church. We need to protect ourselves from the West, from Western forms of the Christian faith, and there are lots of other kind of routes to the situation present. But I think this, yes, this strong move in the opposite direction, that we've got to protect everything that is Russian, that is Orthodoxy, our Russian culture. So the way the media here is portraying the war is very much in terms of these Western countries just want to destroy Russia, want to destroy us, want to destroy our Orthodox faith. And that's been very hard for me personally to live with because I feel it's not true. For on the one hand, the whole Russian media is just full of that. And it's very hard for people to think otherwise. The attitude of being open to the other, being open to learning from the other, which I would very much agree with, and I would very much try to say that to people here, I would say it would fall on deaf ears among an awful lot of people in Russia today. And particularly a certain kind of perhaps more radical right wing of the church. One thing I say to people is the Christian faith isn't there to be protected, it's to be shared. So I feel this whole mindset of we need to protect ourselves from the nasty, faithless West, which is the way Western Europe and just the rest of the world as a whole is being portrayed. It's a completely anti-missionary mindset in many ways. So from the point of view of mission, it doesn't make sense, obviously. Thank God it's not the viewpoint of everybody. So I would say the greatest challenge for me personally, but I would say it's a huge challenge that the Russian church as a whole eventually needs to somehow resolve. But it's not going to be quick, unfortunately, because I think it's something that's been growing over decades and centuries, are the roots of this mindset.
As always, there is so much more to say about the rich and extensive history of the Orthodox Church, the Chuvash people or Christianity in that region in general, and I would encourage everyone to learn more about and engage with the subject matter. But even more, we want followers of Jesus to pray for each other as we all are his body. So let's hear one more time from Alison how we can pray for that region.
Obviously, as I particularly mentioned, the prison ministry and Father Alexei Pavlov, who leads this ministry, which I would say is one of the most exemplary things that I think is going on, despite all the horrors in many ways, to pray for that. And when I look at this whole situation we've been discussing of why the war is taking place and this whole desperate kind of clinging to Russian identity and this militant type of orthodoxy, which I see around me here. At times, I feel like I look at the roots of this ways of thinking, and I think it goes back so far and it has such ingrained roots that I sometimes think, is there any way that it can be overcome? That's the greatest need is for prayer that people like myself, but others who can perhaps see this ingrainedness of some of this prejudice or just ways of thinking, and at times you feel, can God really do anything to overcome that so that there can be some kind of reconciliation? The Russian church likes to talk about the West. I don't like to use that term. I usually try to focus on the fact that there are many different countries and cultures. I think it's part of the problem, really, that Russia has created this image of the West. And obviously the West has created a certain image of Russia. And I think the greatest need is for prayer, that somehow those kind of perhaps what seems like a completely impossible thing to root out of people's way of thinking in such a way that things like this war would not be taking place. In some way, God can raise up a generation of people who will think in a different way and will be willing to say, well, why do we have this hatred towards the West? Where are the roots of this lie? Because I feel like nobody's asking that question. On the whole, everybody's just buying into the propaganda that the Russian media is feeding people. And even Christians, who you'd think, well, we believe in a God who tells us to love our enemies. And yet I don't see very many people saying that to themselves, even among the Christians. Everybody's just buying into this kind of ghastly idea. And, you know, obviously, it's obviously not just on the Russian side, unfortunately. So, you know, that in somehow or other, you know, God can raise up this kind of new generation of people who think differently and can affect the country and the church in such a way.
You've listened to God on the Move, Lausanne Movement podcast, where we want to listen to mission stories from the global church. Through listening to what God is doing around the world, we hope to encourage and challenge the global church to faithful obedience to the Great Commission. So let's accelerate global mission together toward a vision for the gospel for every person, disciple-making churches for every people and place, Christ-like leaders in every church and sector, and kingdom impact in every sphere of society. If you enjoyed listening to this episode, be sure to subscribe and follow us for more.